There, he did it. He's third of the Vendée Globe. It's huge. What a relief for Jérémy Bailloux. 78 days, 6 hours, and 38 minutes. Jérémy Bailloux climbs to the third step of the podium after accomplishing a regatta at the outposts and despite a succession of technical troubles. Wow, this is all so crazy. It's a race that makes itself deserved. It's not one you simply win just like that. Each edition, you gotta look out. It took me 3 editions. And this year, for every mile, every meter won, I needed to surpass myself, get the boat to surpass itself. And when you reach the end, it's hard to describe. It's a huge and intense emotion. After 2 abandons in 2008 and in 2012, this third participation in the Vendée Globe will be the good one, the more so as he closes the world around in less than 80 days. Each day you gotta find resources just to make it to the next day. I really function that way. At some point, I told myself, you gotta look at one day at a time. And when you're considering 2 or 3 days, well, that's okay, but after 70 days, you're kind of exhausted. There's no other challenge of that type. It doesn't exist. In such self-sufficiency, it plain doesn't exist. I discovered it. This third place is a nice revenge for this Finistère sailor, a weather expert, excellent technician, and fine regatta racer, famous for his incredible pugnacity. From the first to the last in the ranking is a tough fight. So to each their own challenge. I tried the performance mode, tried to fight against Armel Lecléache and against Alex Thompson. It's an enormous challenge. 2 fabulous skippers. So there's no shame in finishing right behind them. In the order, in the podium's order with Armel Lecléache in the center. What a beautiful image of this Vendée Globe 2016-2017. The 8th Vendée Globe is the story of a chase over 27,000 miles, a world-around regatta under high tension, and the tone is set right from the start. This is the beginning, and we've had a good start. We're now finding our marks on board. There hasn't been much damages on the boats behind, so that's a good thing. And for us, everything's going well for the moment. Let's enjoy. Alex Thompson isn't in a mood to party. Within 48 hours, he's lost quite some grounds, but the Hugo Boss skipper remains lucid.
Clearly, the jibe I made off of Finistère was a huge mistake, and I've been beating myself up about it. No real excuses. Shouldn't have made the mistake, and I've paid for it dearly.
Alex Thompson is a fighter. After his hazardous option at Cape Finistère, he's catching up on Armel mile after mile and fine-tunes his strategy.
Just going past the first of the Cape Verde Islands. I've forgotten the name of it. I'm only a couple of miles off. I haven't really lost the wind so far. All is good. Please be in second. Not sure I'm going to be in second for long. We'll see after I clear these islands. I'll have to do a couple of jibes are done. That's it for now.
Since Cape Verde, I haven't felt right. Not doing the right moves, so to speak. Until Cape Verde, all was perfect. And then there was a slump. Well, that's part of the game, huh? There'll be more, and others will have some too. Literally sneaking between islands of the archipelago, Alex Thompson took a major risk, but in the end, he's leading the race. But on the route to the equator, another trap is waiting, a real meteorological brain teaser. It's a real battlefield. This is truly the doldrums. Fucking clouds. Fucking clouds at 30 knots. Mustn't get caught unaware. Alex Thompson didn't beat around the doldrums and is now dashing towards the equator.
It's been a fantastic day today. I think that's the easiest doldrum crossing I have ever had. As I get further south, I'll have more wind, and the wind will be further left, which means it's more reachy. I can ease the sails and go faster.
Enjoying exceptional weather conditions, the head of the race glides towards the Cape of Good Hope in record time. It's been 4 or 5 days I haven't been outside. Haven't seen the equator fixing shitty steering problems. But now, I think after 5 days, we found the solution. So, champagne! Foils are letting loose. The problem is that at such speeds, the slightest shock takes a greater dimension. On the 13th day of the race, superstitious abstain, Alex Thompson loses brutally his starboard foil.
Yesterday morning, I was dozing when there was an almighty bang. The boat turned hard to starboard. The rudder popped up. Once I'd managed to get the rudder back down and get the boat sorted out, I realized that the foil had broken, the starboard foil had broken. There's still a bit of it there, jagged edges sticking out the side of the boat, slowing me down. But I can't do anything about that. I can't get it in any further. So at some point I'm going to have to, I guess, go over the side and cut it off. Foil on the other side. I'm hoping that I'll be able to hang out here ahead and praying for lots of starboard tack. And as I've said before, for this race you have to expect the unexpected.
On the 18th day, a radical change of ambiance. The fleece jackets are out. The Great South isn't so welcoming. Let me show you the ambiance outside. It's kind of gray. Still have some wind. And I just maneuvered. I put on the waterproof outfit because it's kind of humid outside. Gotta make myself some tea to warm up.
There is Armel Leclerche on Banque Populaire. He's slowly catching up me overnight. So he's obviously come with a bit better breeze, but I'll be back on starboard in less than a day, so we look forward to that. In the meantime, I'm going to push hard as I can and try and stay in touch with this guy.
Chronicle of an expected duel between the two men who keep taking each other the lead. Yesterday was a great jibe fight. And then to find Alex at early dawn, we were side by side. And then I was able to escape a little, so that's kind of good. One good thing done. Sixth week of the race, conditions are hardening. A great strain is put on the equipment, on men also. They're subject to fast rhythms and worn out. The Great South, in all its outrageousness, with its strings of depressions.
The boat's flying down waves at 30 knots sometimes before coming to an almost complete standstill. And it just means that you're being thrown around all over the place. You can hear the water rushing over the deck. And it's now that your mind starts to wonder what's going to happen. What happens if the structure fails? What happens if you hit something? I do wonder why I do it sometimes.
At the very end of the South Pacific, Armel Leclerche has widened the gap with Alex Thompson. He's 800 miles ahead.
23 December 2016.
December 23rd, 2016. It's the Cape Horn. Right there. End of the South Seas. Start of the Atlantic in just a few minutes. Feels good. Let's have some champagne to celebrate the moment. 47 days and 32 minutes, a record. Armel Leclerche lowers by more than 5 days the reference time established by François Gabart in 2012. So, cheers to the Cape Horn, to the skipper, it's at a good temperature, nice and cool. Jérémy Bayou passes South America's tip in third position, 2 days, 2 hours and 2 minutes after Thompson. He too hopes for a redistribution of cards after the Cape Horn. I believe the race will take on its normal course. I'll look ahead and figure where I stand against the two in the lead. Against Alex, the trajectories they took, the ones I'll choose to take. The game will open up a bit. It'll become another race, a new race somehow. The Atlantic's ascent looks like most tactical. the Breton chap is negotiating delicate passages caught between the Antarctic exclusion zone and tricky anti-cyclonic bubbles. The Welsh in ambush has caught up close to 700 miles in less than 6 days, and Armel helplessly loses his edge hour after hour. Nothing is yet set in this eighth on the globe. He just had one jibe to do after the Cape Horn. He's been going straight ever since. I've had to beat, go downwind, do several jibes. It's sure that these 800 miles quickly came down to almost nothing. And it should still lower in the next hours. But we'll figure it out in the next days. See if he also didn't have to slow down in the high-pressure area. And figure what the gaps will be like then. I'm not going to give in anyway. It's Figaro mode. We're going to fight hard. On January 18th at dawn, 39 miles only separate the two men who will have to choose the most delicate, the most decisive tack in the whole race.
There's no real option for me anymore. Doesn't look like there's any after the tack is going to be wind. So, I think my options have run out. I'm very tired, so I don't have any tension about the finish. I have tension about trying to make the autopilot work so I can sleep.
The end of the story we know already. On January 19th at 4:37 p.m., Armel Leclerc easily wins the 8th Vendée Globe. Top arrival at Banque Populaire, arrival at Banque Populaire, winner of the Vendée Globe 2016. Racing time, 74 days, 3 hours, 35 minutes, 46 seconds. I didn't give in, not a single meter. Each inch was hard to win. I wanted this victory so badly. I succeeded. Armel, Alex, and Jérémy, and all three under the mythical 80 days mark. After Jean-Pierre Dick, Yann Eliès, and Jean Le Cam, the arrivals will follow at Les Sables d'Olonne until the very last solitaire expected at the beginning of March.